Just before this, I started this video, I was focusing on the people back east who are having trouble. I know a lot of viewers of these videos are from back east. And what came to me was that you need to just hang in there a little while longer, okay? And after I had that thought, a hummingbird came up right in front of me, right in front of my face, and hung in the air for several seconds, not a long time, and then pew, took off. It's amazing. I said, okay, hang in there just a little while longer. Won't take long. It will not take long. Sometimes the best you can do is just to hang in there. Okay. And you can do that. So just do that. And there's reason to do that, and I'll tell you why, because this morning I had this tremendous crystalline clarity about what the remedy is. I touched on it last night, and this morning I was able to get back to it, and the whole thing was just seen in utter simplicity. Very, very clear. So it's actually a tremendous, tremendous situation that's coming now. As I said, there will be the momentum of October is now being carried over into November. And there's going to be a response to the world situation. The existence is the kingdom of belief. And the question is, how can you get free of the kingdom of belief? Because you, in the kingdom of belief, you suffer all sorts of misery. When Jesus was leaving this world, they asked him, where are you going? You have to stay with us. This is your kingdom. And he said, no, this is not my kingdom. You know, this is the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of the adversary, etc. The adversary is belief. And he said, I'm going to the kingdom of heaven. All right. So obviously there is another place that is not ruled by belief. We are in a situation right now in this world that is incredibly corrupt and is going to become amazingly corrupted, especially the legal system, especially in America. The rest of the world is already quite corrupt. But the idea was America was somehow a shining light, but it is now going to be drastically corrupted, especially the legal system. And so you might say, well, what do we do, you know? Well, what remedy do we have? There's absolutely a remedy, tremendous remedy. It's hard to apply it specifically to the pragmatic, practical, everyday situations, but it will apply to that in some way. So we don't need to be discouraged in any way at this point, except obviously those who have been suffering from a lot of belief traumatizing itself. Just hang in there. Hang in there. Help is on the way. Help in maybe a way you don't even expect. Okay. First thing is to realize that not everybody is being traumatized like you are. Around the world, whoever's being really feeling the trauma coming on them, not everyone is in that situation. And for instance, my situation is very good, very good, and getting better all the time. The clarity is taking exponential, you know, dimensions to it. It's just extraordinary. And I'm very optimistic and very confident of the future, of what's going to that there is some tremendous, tremendous big boost coming. So do not get discouraged. You may not be floating, you know, just like everything's great. But sometimes it helps to know that somewhere the sun is shining, right? It's very helpful. And that you are not lost or forsaken. You simply need to hang in there, continue your inquiry and satsang and focus. And just know that you're going to get through this for sure. Now, in a nutshell, I can explain it in a nutshell. The remedy is simply to allow the effect of what's called the overlay to arise within you, to experience that. And this overlay overlays all belief, all people, persons, things, places, and situations. All space and time is equally overlaid. And this effect is not coming from any person, place, or situation, okay, or time. It's not coming from anywhere. It's because it's equally everywhere. And you're saying, I can't see where it's arising from. And then that becomes your path. Where is this arising from? Where is this effect coming from? And that's when you abide in this, you are actually focusing on where is it coming from. That it becomes your focus. and you know it's not coming from any person, place, situation, or time. So your awareness, your focus becomes, where is it coming from? And by focusing on that, you automatically, you begin to see where it's coming from. And you get clearer and clearer and clearer, and you see it's coming from causation, true causation, and not from effects. And by seeing true causation, where it is, more and more and more and more clearly, you then realize, all this time I've been searching for causation within effects, which is the kingdom of belief, is simply the searching for causation within effects. That's all that it is. There is no causation within effects. So now you see where causation really is, and you say, I'm home. I'm back, I'm home. No reason to go searching out in darkness for causation and effects. It's finished, it's over, and that's it. And then from that point on, you're able to function as reality created you to function. So, that's it in a nutshell. That's absolutely it in a nutshell. That it's that simple. And it's that clear. It is that clear. That's all there is to it. So the question for our standpoint is then allowing this effect to arise of this perfect overlay. You can call it unconditional love or peace beyond understanding, or whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter. It's simply this blissful, seamless, tranquil, peaceful, wonderful overlay over all of existence. Okay. Without exception. There's nowhere where it is not. and it simultaneously arises, like simultaneously. And then automatically we recognize, wait a minute, this isn't coming from anyone. No situation, no person, no thing, no place. It's not, because it's everywhere equally. And then we start to inquire, Where is it coming from? Very natural thing, situation. That is truly the remedy. There is no other remedy. That is the remedy. And it's totally simple. And it's easy for me to explain it at this point. And we don't, we have our habits. We have been habituated to searching for cause within effects. Because we want, the origin of all this search for cause within effects was that we wanted to experience being prime creator. In other words, we're the effect of prime creator, and we want to quote unquote the effect, the creation. We're the creation of the prime creator, but we are created to have causation. Okay, we are created like the prime creator, so we do have causation. But we didn't create the causation. We wanted to be the creator of our own causation. Let's put it that way. We wanted to be the creator of our own causation. So the only place we could look for that would be in effects, because we are not the creator of our own causation. So we tried to make it, we're trying to make it, make put causation within effects, because we are, quote unquote, an effect of the prime creator, even though we are created with the power of causation. So belief has no causation to it, because it's literally an attempt to reverse the direction of creation and for us to be the creators of our own causation. So as we search for this power of causation within belief, and this is all these effects are really just the imagination of belief, just belief. We can't find causation here. We cannot find it. At the level of effects, there is no causation. See, we were created to have causation, but also to give rise to effects to complete the loop of creation, to show that causation does have effects, has power. Okay, but the causation is not within the effects. The effects did not create their own causation. And we are trying to do that. We are trying to be the creators of our own causation. So we're searching for causation within effects, which is futile, which is absolutely futile. It's a completely futile search. Punjabi said, call off the search. There are a lot of teachers that came from Punjabi. Call off the search. But it's being explained here very simply and clearly about the whole situation, how it's resolved. You allow this effect, this overlay, to arise. You're willing to experience it. There's no trick to it. There's no trick to it. It's just you have to put it in the right, align yourself in the right direction, and then you get that push. Here it comes. So it hasn't yet come to me, but the context has become crystal clear, crystal clear. And will it come? Well, I would think so for sure, but I'm not going to, predict anything on that account. But the context is very crystal clear and probably will become even more clear. So for sure it's possible to see the context, to see the problem and therefore see the remedy very clearly. I can see the problem, very, very clearly, because I'm not searching within effects to find the answer. You see, belief believes it can find the answer. Where? Within effects. It cannot. It cannot. So you have to see the situation from the level of causation, which is what's called reason or divine reason. The Holy Spirit, the grace of God, divine reason comes from the level of causation, and it informs us about the situation here. It's not belief. Belief keeps trying to inform us, and it's just crazy. It says your problem is you haven't gone to the right place or the right situation or met the right people or et cetera, et cetera. As if effects have causation. They do not. The problem is we haven't seen the situation for what it is. We haven't clearly seen the situation. The only way we can see the situation as it is to listen to this internal voice of clarity. We can call it that, the voice of clarity. A Course in Miracles says a voice, the voice of reason. I say, well, the voice of clarity, really, because it clarifies. And you can see, it shows you very clearly what the situation really is here, that we're searching for causation within effects. That's futile. And then when you see what we're trying to do, then the remedy is suggested to us, and we say, ah, that's a perfect remedy. Of course that will solve the problem that we're suffering from. Because instead of searching within effects for causation, this overlay will automatically turn us in the direction of searching at the level of causation for causation. We'll look for causation where it is. The only way we can be motivated to do that is by this overlay that is equally overlays everything simultaneously. Everything is equally overlaid by this perfect, calm, tranquil effect, which is not trying to change what it is. It's not searching for causation within the effect, okay? It's not searching for causation within the effect, so it's not engaged in any search. No impermanence, no change, no trauma, all this kind of stuff that's going on. It's not there. And so we just abide in that. Remember that Ramana, when he had this overlay, this effect, he spent a lot of times just in a cave, on Arunachala, just abiding in it and looking for the cause of this effect. Absolutely. And then when he found the cause of this effect, then, he was absolutely there. And you got the great witnessing in this world. So when this effect arises, we abide in that effect and we focus on where is this coming from. And we don't have to go to a cave on Arunachala. We don't have to starve ourselves. The various traditions handle this situation differently. But, here, I don't know exactly how it'll work out, but from my own feeling is it'll just work out like easily. So you don't have to go into some, retreat. I don't feel that way at all. I feel like the context is very clear here. So I just will simply, just keep my stride going, I would think. That's how I see it. And just witness that, hey, yeah, this is it. This is it. Nobody's far away from this. They simply have to listen to the voice of clarity, which is why this channel is called Christ Clarity. It means the voice of clarity. Christ means a level of causation. That's what it means. Clarity about the level of causation, not seeking for it anywhere else. So you're just know where causation is, so then you can use it. You're not confused. You're not trying to use causation to reverse causation anymore. So everything that is flawless and perfect the way that it's always been. So Christ clarity. Listen to the voice of clarity. And that just simply clarifies this essential fact. That's it. Because that's all we really need to know, of what's the problem, and then the remedy, obviously we'll see, it fits. It fits. The shoe fits. The remedy fits. The remedy fits the problem. And then we say, okay, let's go with that. Let's go with that remedy. So it's not at all, it's way easier and simpler than we realize, because we keep listening to belief, and belief, of course, sends us on a wild goose chase. And that's very, very difficult. You know, and belief will say, all you need is better entertainment, you know, better effects. You'll find the cause within this really great entertainment. No, you will not. You'll find entertainment. That's what you find. You know, when you go looking for entertainment, what do you find? You find entertainment. Do you find anything beyond the entertainment? No, you do not. You do not find unconditional love, the overlay. You do not find the remedy for the situation. You simply get a few moments, some pleasant moments of being entertained. Maybe a chuckle, a laugh, entertained, amused. You know, you listen to music. It's you know, kind of temporarily soothing. But there is no remedy there at all for the situation we're in. And with entertainment comes a return ticket also to continued search. Because we will continue searching until we come accept the remedy for the search. You know, we're engaged in a search for causation within effects. And we don't realize that the downside of that is what belief is really attempting to do as we're searching is it's trying to come up with a power to destroy reality, to a way to threaten and destroy reality. So as we're searching, the vehicles of the search are constantly being traumatized and being brought to dead ends, dead ends, dead ends, dead ends. So, you know, when we head out in the search, we kind of think, hey, this should be fun. And after a while, we say, boy, you know, we're getting really badly beat up here. What's going on? You need to realize that it's the destructivity is the way that we're trying to reverse the direction of creation, of having effects be the cause of their own cause. Okay, we have to change reality in order for that to be true. We'd have to change reality, and the way to change reality, we can't find any way. We're trying to find a way to threaten it, to force it to change, as it were. And so we keep trying to force ourselves, threaten ourselves, bring ourselves to an end, which is why death, sickness, all this stuff. trying to bring the way that reality is to an end. So we symbolize reality. This is all symbolic. Existence is symbolic. It's a way of symbolizing reality. Okay. But the essential, even more essential, is the remedy, is to recognize that we need to see causation where it really is. That is all we need to do. Nothing more than that. Nothing more than that. See causation where it really is. And because we're so habituated to searching, we don't feel we can do this directly. Okay, we feel it would be a break in continuity from our habit. And indeed it would. It would be a huge break in continuity from our habits. Because we're in the habit of searching and not finding. And searching in effects. We're in the habit of searching within effects. Okay. So we could see it directly. I actually came upon it, and I recognized the whole dynamic, and I said, wow, I could see it directly, but I'm so habituated to searching within effects, the habit of searching, I'm kind of like nervous about dropping the search entirely. Okay, Punjaji said, drop the search. Okay, well, that's not so easy to do. What we really need to do is we need to turn the search in a different direction, and we need to have that which enables us to do that. in this overlay, automatically we say, where's this coming from? And we look, says, not there, not there, not there. It's not coming from any, not coming from anything or place or situation. No. So where is it coming from? And our attention, it becomes, very focused on that. And then we eventually see where it's coming from. And at that point, we can truly drop the search. At that point. But we really need to have a smooth transition so we don't have a break in continuity with our habits, which is searching within effect. This unconditional love is an effect. This overlay is an effect. So while we start searching within this effect, we see it's seamless. It's seamless. And automatically our search becomes for its origin. And in our origin, and the search automatically focuses on causation, on true causation. That's how it works. Because when you're looking at something that's utterly seamless and the same everywhere, automatically we say, hey, wait a minute. This is one effect. There's not a whole bunch of effects. This is just one effect. And it's equally everywhere. So it can't be its own cause. I don't think it can't be anywhere within the effect. The cause cannot be within this effect. It becomes extremely apparent to us. And then we start looking for the level of causation. What is really causing this effect to arise? Whereas right now, within belief, we're not looking at the level of causation at all. We're looking simply within effects, like what effect, where's the power coming from within effects? That's all that we're looking. It's like we're looking on the surface instead of beneath the surface. How certain am I of this? I'm very certain of it. It all fits with my whole history, all the insights I've had. It fits perfectly. So there's an alignment here that is very much aligned. And since I can get this alignment, you can too. Absolutely can. If you listen to the voice of clarity within, it's within you. It is absolutely within you. This has come. Sure, I've got some help from some teachers, etc. But this clarity is always been within me, and the experiences of a break of seeing this is my own experiences within me, and it's always stayed with me no matter what. This voice of clarity is always there, and it's simply a will to clarify is there, and this will to clarify, an absolute certitude that it can be clarified, stands up to the bully of belief. There's something within you that can stand up to the bully of belief. And I experienced that, in my life. I experienced that. Somehow I stepped back from my efforts, and there was this strength within me that I saw it stand up to the whole universe and said, no, I'm not, I know the truth. And the truth is not within searching within any of these effects. And I said, wow, there's something within me that is, what is that? Ah, wow. A leaf just, something came, woof. It was a leaf. Wow, something within me stood up. There's a bird hopping all around too here. Okay, stood up to the bully of belief. And I said, I've got it within me, I know. There's something within me that can do this, that is absolutely certain of truth, of its direction, and what the remedy is, absolutely certain. And so from that point on, I was aware that it was always with me. Sometimes I didn't turn to it for the will to clarify, but most of the time, every day, in some way, I would do this. It's still with me, and I'm positive it's with you, 100% certain. It's within all of us. Causation is still within all of us, even though we've been searching for it somewhere where it isn't. It's still with us. Just because we've been looking where it isn't doesn't mean it's not still with us. We haven't lost it. We think we've lost it. We think, oh, it's lost within all these effects. Now I have to go find it, search within a universe and try to find where is causation lost. I lost it. No, it hasn't been lost. When we search for it within effects, it seems lost to us because it's not there. We can't see it. We can't experience it. So we're in a great situation. We're in a great situation. And externally, of course, what's happened in the world is the will to continue searching for causation within effects is making its push, its big push, which is certainly happening. That's what's happened in the world recently, last 50 years, and more and more and more and more and more. And it's predominating in the world to an extraordinary extent now. The continued will to search for causation within effects is making, you know, a stand. You know, it's making a very, very strong stand in the world. But at the same time, the will to accept the overlay and look for causation where it must be is also making a very strong stand. I tell you, that is stronger. That is stronger. But we do have free will. Okay, we do have the capacity to search for will where we want to search for it. And if we want to search for it where it isn't, we're free to do that. We have absolute freedom. But of course, we won't find it within effects. But we are also free to choose it where it is, to choose to search for it where it must be found. We can do that. That is absolutely possible for us at this point. And so the big boost is coming. For those who want to exercise the will of clarity to look for causation where it must be, to find it where it is, that will is going to be here also, very strongly, very strongly. So this recent election and all this stuff, we can turn the page now. For a couple days I was like a little bit, you know, shaking a little bit, and now I've got my mojo back, better than ever. You know, saying, hey. And the most important thing to point out from a practical standpoint is don't try to scapegoat anybody. That's the huge mistake, that the trap that people are being led into. You know, as if there's some, because that narrows down your focus, and you're looking for scapegoats, who to blame. And when you try to find who to blame, you lose your wideness of vision of the totality of the problem. You know, and you're still searching for effects, like some, you know, there's some effect that's causing me problems or something. No. It's the search for causation within effects that's causing the problem. Not somebody within effects that is causing the problem. Not really. So you want to get away from blame. So you just exercise forgiveness. No one in particular is to blame. Of course, there are some movers and shakers that seem to be leading the charge towards continued search for causation within effects. But that is really irrelevant, because the whole situation is coming from the level of causation in the first place, of trying to change reality, and it has to be. The solution remains the same, which is to accept this unconditional overlay, which overlays everything equally. So if you're trying to blame someone, you say, well, I don't want them to be overlaid with unconditional love. But that's not the point. You'll miss the point. It's not that anyone is being overlaid by unconditional love, by this overlay. It's that everything is being overlaid simultaneously. So we need to start clarifying this more and more. Forgiveness, don't blame anyone, because belief is just, it's the entire situation that is the problem. It's not anyone, any person, any place, any situation that's the problem. It's our attempt to be the causation of our own causation that is the problem. It's spirit that is trying to be its own cause, own causation, instead of the prime creator being the causation of spirit. That is the problem. And everything else is just an effect of this problem, which brings about this search. And of course, within this search, there will be all sorts of actors upon the stage. But don't even pay any attention to any actors on the stage, a stage of belief, okay, who are seem to be promoting this, because it's really belief that's promoting it. Whatever meat suits are moving around, it's belief that's promoting it, and it's actually spirit that's trying to be the causation of its own causation that is the problem. That idea of wanting to be prime creator, being the causation of itself, that is the problem. And the remedy is to choose this overlay. That is the remedy. And of course, people will struggle with this a little bit. And as soon as I start trying to, you know, talk about people, individuals, the wheels start coming off. Very important to not talk about individuals, people, at all. You'll lose your way if you do that. Keep focusing on the remedy. What is the remedy? Okay, so let our focus be on the remedy. We know what the problem is, searching within for causation within effects. Doesn't matter who's leading the search. What is actually going on? See what's actually going on, not who's leading the search. Not who's promoting the search. That's not important. What is the search is the question, not who's promoting it. Because ultimately, the promotion of it is all comes from the will of spirit to try to choose the idea of wanting to be its own causation. And that can be changed. And spirit can say, no, I'll accept my causation as coming from the prime creator. I'm not my own causation. That's the remedy. So, and to get to see causation where it must be, we need this overlay. We need this effect. We need this effect. And those who are promoting the search within effects, they can't give us this effect. Nobody can give us this effect. No one can give us this effect. It arises within us when we accept it, when we have room at the inn. As Jesus pointed out, he said, there's no room at the inn here for me. He's saying, you know, nobody here will give me room. In other words, this overlay, you know, there's nobody here has a room in their house for it. You know, no room at the inn. It's turned away. So we simply need to focus on that. So these leaders and movers and shakers of the will to keep on searching within effects for causation, they can't give us anything. So why spend any time criticizing them as if they can give us something? If they just, you know, stop what they're doing, they could give us something. They cannot. They're not the ones where the responsibility to clarify is coming from. So why even give them any attention at all? If you give attention, first and foremost, give attention to your own voice of clarity within you. First and foremost. Secondarily, give attention to those who are clarifying and encouraging you. Those external ones who are help clarifiers, okay? And that's it. Don't go tertiary saying, I need to put my attention on those who are trying to, you know, assert an opposite will or something. Now forget it. They don't have anything they can give you at this point. They're lost within the search, so they're not really helpful for you. So don't even put your attention on them. Say, turn the page, you know. And just say, well, you know, at this point, you know, they're of zero help whatsoever. So if something's of zero help, why keep hammering them saying, hey, help, help, help? No, that's not wise. Turn your attention to what can help. First and foremost, the voice of clarity within you, voice of reason, voice of clarity within you. Secondarily, those external who have listened to the voice of clarity to the point where they're able to clarify and encourage and help you, you know, keep encouraging you to listen to the voice of clarity and clarify for you and help you that way, you know. Help you get to the point where there's room within you for this overlay to arise, for this effect to arise within you. That's it. We have to get there. And again, like I say, it has not yet arisen within me. But chances are it will, you know. Chances are it will. Eventually it will, for sure. How soon, I don't know. But I'm making room for it, making room for it, making room for it. There's no doubt that they're, you know, the situation is such that they're, you know, we're making room for it here. Just as you're working to make room for this effect to arise within you. And it could arise within you today. Who knows? I don't know that. And it could arise for me, you know, today too, also. Possible. What I feel is it's getting to the point where there's a, you know, some likelihood that it will arise, because I don't really see too much else to clarify, you know. It's more like I need to now start looking for the source of this effect. Would be the right thing to do at this point. I've clarified the whole situation there. It's basically I don't need to keep on working on that, really. Wouldn't serve much purpose at this point for me. But again, never count your chickens until they're hatched. So I'm not really worried about it. You know, when will it come or whatever. I don't really want to focus on that. You know, it's not over till the last out. I remember the Giants were what was it? 9-3 or 8-3 in the final game of the World Series. And I'm still focused on every pitch and saying, you know, make the perfect pitch here, you know. I wasn't the slightest bit thinking about, oh, they've got the World Series won. No way. My mind was not even there in the slightest bit. And that's why it's hard right now to even realize they won, because I was focused. Every pitch has to be just spot on. No thought of you're close to something at all. No thought about that even entered my mind, that you're really close. No. You just have to make the perfect pitch. And then when you make the final pitch and it's over, it's over. Okay. But don't start celebrating before it's over. Very important. So I'm not, patting myself on the back or celebrating really or anything, because it's not over yet. It's not over. I might be a pitch away, but, a pitch away, is still not there at all. And, the other team can always rally if you let them get back in. I could always be pulled into searching within effects again. Absolutely. In fact, the last couple of days I have been. I've been listening to entertainment, listening to some bands, which I haven't done in a long time. Which is why belief is saying, hey, take a look at this band. What do you think? It does it to ask my opinion, because it knows I'm very, sophisticated in that way. And so it says, what do you think about this band? And of course I can give an expert opinion. And so it flatters me that way. And I look at the listener and I say, wow, that's a really, really great band. Maybe one of the best ever. And the belief says, oh, wow, really, you really know a lot about that, don't you? And I say, yeah. So it flatters you that way. And I say, well, what am I doing? I'm paying attention to entertainment. And looking for something to get something within effects. Looking for causation within effects. Say, uh-oh, tricked again. Belief can really flatter you. It'll do that. It'll get you to look within gurus. Which guru is really great, And I'll say, yeah, I'm very sophisticated that way. And I'll say, well, this guru is really good. Or this one, is not, doesn't seem to be quite there. And I'll give my opinions of stuff. There again, wasting time. So belief is expert at getting you to do with your time. Absolute expert. And that's just par for the course. It's like you're reeling off all these pars on a golf course. And, you'd like to get birdie, of course, but you just say, okay, I should have birdied that one, but I didn't, because I didn't quite approach it the right way. My drive was not quite long enough on the right side of the drive, the fairway, and my approach shot, I didn't quite approach it in the right way, and I got a little far away, it's belief does distract us, and it can do it in many ways, and flattering is one of the ways. It'll say, hey, I need your help here. Can you look at this band for me and tell me, if are they really as good as I think? And it's like you're the expert. It goes to you and asks for your expertise. That's a mistake. Of course it's a mistake. And you get tricked all the time. Belief is the great trickster. And so you'll give your expertise and belief will thank you. But also, then it'll start broadening, well, what about this band? How do they add up to that? And how can they get better? And before you know it, you're giving all this advice about effects, about entertainment. You become a consultant, an entertainment consultant. And belief is consulting you, and you feel like you're some kind of, bigwig consultant. Boy, I got tricked into all that, big time. And that's par for the course, absolutely par for the course. You have to forgive yourself for being tricked. Because if you weren't tricked, let's put it this way, prior to this overlay arising within you, this seamless effect, prior to that, you will, all the time, you will be tricked. You have been tricked. The entire time you've been tricked. Along with listening to the voice of clarity, you're still being tricked. So everybody has been tricked. With rare exception, Anandamayi was born with perfect knowing where causation is. So she never searched for effects at all. So that was one example of someone who was never tricked, ever. But that is super rare here, super rare. Everyone else, almost everyone else, with, you know, other than these super rare exceptions, are being tricked in some way. And some of us, you know, are tricked by playing the role of consultant, where we're, you know, belief comes to us and bows to us, says, you're so wise, you're incredibly sophisticated, I really want to use you as a consultant, you know, of, and we say, well, really, why? And we're flattered by that, you see? But where it's consulting is, how can we make effects more attractive so we keep searching within effects for cause? That is what it's doing. And so I can say, yeah, okay, this band, you know, is really way superior to the other bands. There's some singers, there's some bands, there's some music that's way superior. They have the X factor. And belief says, oh, really? Okay. And how can we make other bands like that? You know, how can we get them better? How can we make entertainment better? So people will keep searching for causation within effects because the effects are very pleasant, very sublime. And if you're like an artist, like paint or something, you know, belief will come to you and say, hey, you know, I'd like to consult with you. You're so talented at this. Can you tell me what's great art? You know, what is great art? Or great dance, if you're some great dancer. You know, there's some people who are really great dancers, and belief will come to them and say, I really want to consult with you. I understand you're an expert. You're absolutely incredible. You must be filled with spirit. You know, I just want to ask you, you know, can you show me what is great dance? Who are the great dancers? Or if you're a great singer, same thing. Some people are great singers. If you're great at anything, business, you name it, belief will come to you and say, I really want to consult with your great wisdom. And then you'll say, if you're great at spirituality, it will come to you and say, I want to consult with you. If you're great, you know, rituals, whatever it is, if you're great at it, no matter what it is, you can get hooked and flat by the flattery of the ego, of belief. It's really belief coming and bowing to you and asking for your wisdom as a consultant. And you say, wow, you know, okay, you know, I'll help you out. It's asking for help, I'll help you out. You're hooked, you know, you get hooked, you're wasting time, you're being tricked, you're being deceived. So, other than those super rare exceptions, we are all in the same boat with that. Prior to this effect arising of unconditional love, of this perfect overlay, prior to that arising within us, we're being deceived, we're being hoodwinked, we're being conned by belief. It's very tricky the way it does it. So of course, we need to be aware of that and try to minimize it, which I've been trying to do. But by no means do I feel I'm out of the woods. By no means. I mean, belief keeps coming up with very sublime stuff, saying, hey, I want your opinion on this. I say, oh, really? Like, what about this video? What about this effect? What about this nature? You know, what about this beauty? What do you think about this beauty? I say, well, yeah, that's really beautiful. What about all these birds flying, you know, in the air, and like a symphony in the air, you know, like a super symphony? What about that super symphony? And I say, well, yeah, that's even better than the other stuff. So belief uses our sophistication against us. It's true, you know. And I know a lot of those of you listening, you're probably very sophisticated in certain ways. And maybe in ways that, you know, most people don't even realize. And it's very important, because I was very much a sophisticate. And it's very important to know how that gets used against us, how we get conned. Okay, how belief cons us into, you know, getting hooked into, once again, the whole situation of searching for causation within belief and not having room in our inn for this effect of this perfect overlay to arise as an effect. It's an effect. And to then search for the cause of that effect. There isn't a sufficient room. When we're trying to search for the best band, there's no room. We say, no, don't. I'm busy. I'm busy. I'm busy comparing bands. I don't have time to, if this effect of this perfect overlay arose, I wouldn't be searching for what the best band in the world is. I wouldn't even be interested in that. I'd be interested in, where is this effect coming from? And then, you know, I wouldn't be flattered. The belief wouldn't be flattering me anymore. So that's the dynamic. That is really the root of the situation, how we keep getting delayed. We keep getting delayed. And don't get angry at yourself and hate yourself and say, I'm stupid. Or, no, this is the trickery of belief. It's very tricky. And we have to continue to try and see through this. Got no choice but to keep seeing through it. Say, ah, fooled again. You know, okay, let's go back to satsang. Let's go back to satsang. I last couple of days, you know, I was fooled. And listening to this super band and these super musicians, and especially that super drummer, you know, the whole band is like, wow. I never realized how great they really were. As far as bands go, you know, they're like, you know, wow. They're like, you know, tippy-top. Top of the toppermost. And then I get intrigued, saying, how are they getting this sound, you know? And I say, ah, the drummer, you know, a band that is driven by the drummer. And I saw, you know, how that can be used to an incredible effect, you know, and say, aha, now I see how to make a super band, you know. I was always trying to make a super band. You know, a lot of my life was working with how to make super music, you know, music that's better than anything else. And so I just was evaluating all music, all musicians, all bands, everything, how to make super music, more sublime, incredibly great stuff. And so I'm always, you know, vulnerable to belief saying, hey, look at this band, you know, maybe you can get some idea from this band of how to make super music. Yeah, like who's the front person for the band? How do you front it right? You know, what how to drive the sound? You know, how does the whole thing go together? And again, that is just a waste of time. Absolute waste of time. But it seems to be a very pleasant waste of time. Same thing with great dancers. You know, how do we make a perfect dance, you know? They're always looking for a better dance, right? If you're a dancer, you're saying, how can we put on this production that is just so dazzling that the audience will just say, wow, this must be where causation is coming from, this super dance. Or if you're some super band, you know, just playing the song that is just like, you just say, oh my gosh, it feels like causation must be coming from here, from this effect. You know, I'm getting this feeling, this is it. And then, of course, what people do, when you have this great, you know, super entertainment, super sublime entertainment, they take drugs so that they can, it becomes, their senses become more enveloped and wrapped around the entertainment, where it blocks out, where this entertainment becomes the whole universe. They're not even considering anything else because everything else is dulled down. The day-to-day life, pragmatic stuff is gone, and they're completely focused on the entertainment and getting into it. So they're trying to get this entertainment, this effect, to be causation, okay, is what's going on. So, of course, if you're trying to build this, you know, dance production, a perfect dance production, or this perfect band, or perfect entertainment, by combining a perfect band with a perfect dance production, with a perfect light show, and then you have the shamans with the perfect drugs, and then you have the audience with the perfect groovy people, you know, grooving to it, the whole production, like a Grateful Dead concert or something. You know, that's all belief, that's all ego, that's simply trying to come up with the causation from coming from effects, from entertainment, you know, from effects. I never went to a Grateful Dead show because I intuitively was aware of what they were doing, you know, what the whole scene was all about. I said, no, 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 no. That's dangerous. That's very dangerous. I only went to a few concerts in my whole life because I realized intuitively, I said, wait a minute, this could get bad for me. This really could be a waste of my life. I don't want to waste my life. You know, I say, let me at least back away from this. I didn't go to parties. I didn't go to concerts. Didn't go to nightclubs. I don't think I've been to a nightclub one time. Terrible situation. Holy cow. I'm telling you, it was a very wicked situation. Holy smokes. It was amazing what happened there. How wicked it was. I mean, I got hit on by some very wicked situations. I was just shocked. I said, are you kidding me? You're trying to pull me into this? You don't even know who I am? They don't care. They don't care. Belief doesn't care who we really are. I have awareness of who I really am, and I'm going in the direction of choosing the overlay of unconditional love, and yet you're still hitting on me? Are you kidding me? You're trying to pull me into this very wicked situation. Holy cow. I was really shocked. I'm just going through that scenario in my mind. That was scary. One time, you know, I was tricked into it in a very clever way. Holy cow. Belief is very tricky. But I tell you, stay away from entertainment, okay? Because you can get hit on within those situations by very potent efforts to pull you down. I was close to being really pulled down. The whole time I was within entertainment, wherever in any entertainment situation, it becomes very nasty. And belief puts its clutches on you. You know, it'll love bomb you. You know, it will throw the whole thing at you where you're vulnerable. It'll try to find where you're vulnerable, and it will make its move on you. Belief will make its move on you. See, it starts out by saying, can you give me your expert opinion? I'm your consultant, and you need to consult. You need to come see this, you know, great guitarist or something. I want your opinion. But as you get there, then it tries to, you know, throw some drinks on you, throw some drugs on you. Then it tries to have some beautiful person, you know, come on to you and say, hey, you know, why don't you, we got a party, you know, somewhere else, so why don't you go there? You know, and more drugs, you know, drugs, sex, rock and roll, all this stuff. And it keeps pulling you down rapidly. It wants to pull you down. You know, I just was there. I just observed the whole thing. And I saw, whoa. I was just like aware of all these levels of maneuvering that belief was doing to absolutely Shanghai me. Really, really. I mean, attempts have been made to Shanghai me. There's no question about it. All in the name of spirituality, too. In the name of spirituality, in the name of music, in the name of, you know, all this stuff, you know. It was all done in the name of that. Like, first it starts out, like I said, well, you're an expert in spirituality and spiritual gurus and knowing the whole spiritual scene. We want your opinion in that. And I say, okay. And then it gets into music. So what kind of music would be best for, like, for some high spiritual teacher, you know? And then I say, well, okay, I'll be a consultant in that. And then it goes on and on. About, how about checking out this music? Maybe this music would be good. So, I'll be a consultant in that. And they said, well, how about, you know, slow, eventually maneuvering. Say, hey, I want you to invite to this nightclub where there's this really great musician playing. I say, well, okay, all right. I felt very uneasy about it. And then once I was in this nightclub, it was getting like really, really wild. I say, well, first it says you're a guest of honor. Okay, he says, yeah, the musician, this great guitarist is personally inviting you to come there to evaluate them. I say, okay, wow, that's really something. Then you get there, and it starts coming really wild, and like these people come in. It's like, who are these people? You know, like, well, these people are really, I didn't feel comfortable there. They seem very decadent, very depraved people coming into the whole nightclub. I say, whoa, this doesn't have the vibe, a spiritual vibe at all. And then, you know, they keep trying to say, hey, drink, drink, drink. I said, no, I don't drink. And everybody's drinking, everybody's taking drugs. And then you have all these sexy people there that are really very loose in their morals, etc. And they start, you know, coming on to you and like, hey, you know, come with us. And I said, you know, no. And they say, oh, but there's really, really great. It gets better and better. The musician's going to go after the nightclub. They're going to go to a private gig, you know. And of course, you know, they're probably inviting you to an orgy or something, really, tell you the truth. And you just say, wow, you know, I thought I was here as a spiritual consultant for some spiritual music, which was supposed to be for some great guru that might come into the world. And before you know it, you're being invited to an orgy with just, you know, the most decadent, depraved thing in the world. It's like, boom, 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 boom. I was like, I'm saying, whoa, no. No. I'm getting deceived here. This is deception. Wow. And it's so audacious, you know. I said, are you kidding me? That's why I said, are you kidding me? Do you even know what I am? Do you even see who I am or anything? No, they didn't. Could care less. They could care less. I said, holy cow. And then I went back home and I cut off all association with the people involved with that whole thing, or supposedly my friends, you know. Phew, that's it. And they only tried one other time to contact me. I never responded, because I said, wow, you know, these people are really tricky in how they operate. And the whole thing quite some time, like 6 months, 8 months, a year or so. And the whole setup, there's a whole setup that is trying to, you know, tries to get you into decay and death and ruination. All starts out with, you know, very, very trickily, flattering you. It might even start out with you giving your opinions on spiritual teachers, you know, and then the whole consultant thing gradually moves you deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper into darkness, into searching within effects. All the while trying to act as if like you're a bigwig, you know, you're being personally invited by these musicians to evaluate them, you know, BS, you know, while you're there. And they say, wow, how tricky. So I've gotten firsthand, you know, experience of how tricky it is and how wicked it is. I was able to say no to it. Say, no, this is off the track entirely, you know. And of course your so-called friends are looking at you like, wow, how can you turn this down? You're embarrassing me, because I personally recommended you to this musician, to this band, that you're here as guest of honor, and now you're turning down all these offers, these drinks and these, quite frankly, prostitutes and whores and all this kind of stuff. And you're saying no to all this. You're embarrassing me. You're making me lose face in front of all my friends. You know, I say, wow, you're really putting the screws to me, huh? Really putting the screws to me. Interesting. I guess, you know, they didn't know who they were dealing with, for sure. Absolutely did not. I guess they never had anyone say no to them. I mean, they were shocked. I mean, the whole situation, I turned the whole thing down. They were absolutely dumbfounded. I guess they never had anyone turn them down. You know, the idea they could be turned down would never even occurred to them. And I just flat out said, no way, turn the whole thing down. And the whole situation, through with that. That's a non-starter. Wow. Unbelievable. A lot of musicians are heavily on drugs. I know that through and through. Very much a fact. Entertainment industry is very, very wicked. Very much so. It's super depraved and corrupt. You don't want to even be a consultant. I was listening to one musician who's an honest, sort of honest musician just yesterday. Very scary thing. They're honest. You know, most musicians are, you know, some wake up and say, hey, you know, this whole thing is really wicked. There are some, you know, I'm not going to use their names, but I know who they are. And listen to them, you know. And this one musician, front person for a band, said, hey, you know, it was half of the people that they knew are dead. Half of them. And they say, how? Drugs. The whole thing killed them. Half. They say at least 50%, if not more. At least 50%, not more, just from drugs. Musicians. That's, you know, that is, it's very true. Absolutely true. And because, you know, in order to try to produce this sublime music, you have to drive yourself more and more, because the audience keeps saying, whoa, that's not it. It wasn't quite it. And so the musician says, oh my gosh, I got to be better. And so they have to keep topping themselves. And in order to do that, they just start taking drugs. All sorts of drugs. They take stimulants to play better, sing better. And then they take downers to come down off the stimulants. And they get in this vicious circle, vicious circle. They take drugs to try and just lose all inhibitions, you know. No inhibitions, no self-consciousness, no morals, no nothing. Simply the entertainment, just to throw themselves 100% into the entertainment where there's nothing else. And then, of course, they're exhausted from this. Their nerves are shaking. They take, you know, other stuff to try and calm themselves down. They start taking this. They can't sleep. They take drugs to try and sleep. Very heavy sleep medication. Then they take drugs to get up in the morning to perform even higher levels. It's an incredibly terrible, vicious cycle they get involved in. So stay away from entertainment at all costs. I, for the most part, I was been extremely good at that. But the belief is extremely clever at how it tries to hook you. Extremely clever. So forgive yourself if you've been hooked, because we all have, you know. And if sometimes you've said yes, just realize that that's the bully of belief intimidating you, and you need to just turn to the voice of clarity, which is not intimidated by belief at all. There's something within you that is absolutely not intimidated in the slightest bit from belief, and could just say no to belief. No, no, and no. And not bothered by that. I once had a friend help me. Sometimes friends help you. And this friend just dropped by my house one day. I was really in a bad situation. Really very bad. And he just said, hey, he just said, just say the heck with them. Just say no, the heck with them. You don't need their approval. You don't need anyone's approval. He just told me that, you know. I'll never forget that. Very grateful for that. And he said, you don't need anybody's approval. Just say no. And I said, you do that? He says, heck yeah. I don't need anyone's approval at all of what I am. And I was like shocked. I think that's the last time I ever saw him. And it made a huge difference. From that point on, I started realizing, wait a minute, maybe I don't need to be a consultant. Maybe I can say no. Just say no to that. I don't need any approval from belief from all these people, you know, who want to flatter me, you know. Don't need to. I can say no. I don't need their approval. So that kind of is like, you know, standing up to this bully of belief. Standing up to those who want to flatter us and say, hey, I mean, I know people who have been flattered to an unbelievable extent, like some world organization will tell them they need them as a consultant. So the most powerful organizations are the most, on the whole planet, have said, hey, we really value your expertise and we really want you to be a consultant to us. And, you know, you can have tremendous power and you will be consulting with heads of state, leaders, presidents. They'll literally be listening to your advice, because that's where they're really getting the advice. And most of the leaders of the world are getting their advice from these world organizations and these NGOs and all this kind of think tanks, etc. That's where they're getting their policy from. And so you will be asked to give advice, be a consultant to these world organizations. How flattering is that, you know? You have to just be able to say no to that. Absolutely not. Because what are these world organizations and these heads of state and what is all this about? Searching for causation within effects is what it's all about. And what they believe is that you have some insight of where to search and who the leaders of the search should be. Really? That is the absolute direct truth. Who the leaders of the search should be, how to search, and where to search. That's what they want to know. And they're coming to you and saying, you must know the answer to that. And of course you don't, because you cannot find causation within belief. So you have to be able to say no. There's that within you which can say no to that. Not even any problem whatsoever. No, no, and no. But, you know, belief will hit you where you're weakest, always. always. And for me, it was music, because I was such an expert, super expert in you know, I wanted to use that expertise to help people. And so belief, you know, used that was my weak spot, and it exploited that weakness in me to an extraordinary extent and caused me drastic problems, which I still have. It caused me financial problems. I still have them. Drastic problems. So it will hit you where you are weakest, always. And that's different for everybody. You know, I can't cover the entire scope of all situations. I have to give you just the overview, right? It's going to hit you where you're weakest and flatter you where you can be flattered. And if you have all whatever you've built up, you want to use it to help people, it will tell you, oh yeah, okay, I'll show you how to help people by, you know, and then it'll start this process of tearing you down and distracting you and delaying you from this effect, unconditional love overlay, perfect overlay from arising. It will delay that for you, and you just have to get back on track, turn towards that within you which can dismiss all this and just say no. We can stand up to the bully belief. I can only stand up to a certain extent, but at least it gives you some encouragement that there's somebody in the world at least can stand up to some extent. You know, it's not perfect for sure, but there, I know within me, there is this capability that's perfect, that can stand up to it perfectly. Sri Anandamayama stood up to it perfectly. Perfectly. So I know it's possible. I know that within us. And she said, it's within us. Within us, we have the capacity to stand up perfectly to belief and never get tricked by it at all. Never. It was impossible to flatter her. Impossible. Everybody tried. Everybody tried. Nobody could do it at all. So I say, I know it's possible. And we have to get there to the point where we cannot be deceived by belief. We can't be flattered by belief. You know, like, you know, even to the point, you know, where some great guru and the belief comes to us and says, oh, you can really save the whole world. Please, we need you as a consultant to this NGO or this world organization, and we'll put you as the spiritual consultant to this world organization. I'll try to flatter you that way. No, they tried that with Anandamayama. She says, sorry, you got no chance. I got no possibility that's ever going to happen. So you're wasting your time, is what she said. And eventually she'd just leave him because she'd say, you know, I don't want to waste your time anymore because you're obsessed with this. So I'm just going to, I have to leave. That's what happened. Because, you know, they're obsessed with that. You know, oh, she must know where to find the causation with. She found it somewhere. So she can tell us how to find it, where to find it, who can help us, and, you know, how to find it. She says, no, you cannot find causation within effects at all. You're engaged in a completely futile search. She knew it perfectly, but within us, there's that within us which knows it perfectly as well. Perfectly. It's that the voice of clarity comes from the level of causation, and it knows perfectly where causation is. It knows where causation is. And what causation is. It knows it perfectly. That is within us. Each of us has that within us, without exception, without exception. So we just simply have to keep listening to this voice of clarity. And we will start standing up. We'll be tricked less and less and less and less and less. And whatever vulnerability we have, we'll become less vulnerable to it. I mean, like yesterday and the day before, I realized I was being, there's an attempt to trick me. And I kind of went along with it just a little bit, but then I pulled away from it, you know, and I'd say, ah, okay. And it wasn't such a tough thing to do. You know, I just said, okay, there you go again. There you go again. And you want me to fit this music to some video, and you want me to pull in some spiritual gurus, and you want me to blend all this into entertainment, and okay, there you go again. There you go again. I said, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm still tempted, though, to do it, you know, a little bit, but I'm still saying, okay, no. And I'm not so, like, upset by not doing it, because, you know, belief gets furious if you don't do what it tells you. It's shocked. It says, what are you, crazy? I'm giving you this super great opportunity, and you're turning it down. Are you nuts? You could help the whole world, you know, and you're not doing it. Are you selfish? And I just, the voice of clarity just says, ah, you've heard that one before. I remember I clarified that for you. I say, yeah, you did. Says, oh, there he comes again. There's that one. I've clarified that one. I said, yeah, you did. I said, there's running that con on you. I clarified that, right? I said, yeah, yes, you did. So I say, no. I don't feel bad. You know, I don't feel selfish. I don't feel lazy. I don't feel like I'm not helping the world out stuff. The way to help the world is to accept the overlay. That is the way. That is the way to help the world, maximally. And not be tempted at all to search for causation where it cannot be found. That is the ultimate how to help the world, ultimately. Someone like Anandamaya Ma helped the world in the ultimate way by never being tempted, never searching for causation within effects, even for an instant, never. That is a huge help for us in the world, huge. And for us to allow the overlay to arise within us is immense help to the world, immense help. Because then people can see we're searching for causation where it is. And they say, oh, you're doing it, I can do it too. This is it. And until we do that, we will, you know, continue to be tricked. And I just have to point this out and just ask you to continue to pull away from that trickeration and just say no. Do it. Just say no. Just pull away. You don't have to get in a big argument. Don't get in a big argument with belief. Just turn to the voice of clarity and say, hey, isn't this, didn't we cover this before? And voice of clarity will say, yeah. Say, isn't this like a trick? It's trying to fool me. And voice of clarity will say, yeah, absolutely. That's it. And say, okay. Don't argue with belief. Belief is insane. You cannot win an argument with insanity, right? It's impossible. Impossible. Because what is there within insanity that can recognize the sanity of your argument? There's nothing there. You can't win an argument with insanity. So don't argue with belief. Just turn to clarity and say, hey, wait a minute. This seems very familiar. This has a very familiar feel to it. Feels like belief is trying to trick me and flatter me again and pull me in that direction. And a bit of clarity will say, yes, it is. That's exactly right. And I say, yeah, but it's kind of pleasant. I'd enjoy this music. And the voice of clarity will say, yeah. You enjoy the music. But is that what you really want? I'll say, no, it's not what I really want. And then I say, well, how do I get what I really want? And the voice of clarity says, well, keep on clarifying. And you'll say, but I'm tired. You know, that's all I ever do. I've been doing that for my whole life. And I haven't got it yet. Maybe I'll never get it. The voice of clarity say, no, you'll get it. I say, yeah, but I'm tired. He says, yeah, you're tired. I know. But just don't get into this, you know, distraction too much. You know, kind of, you know, just sort of don't get wrapped up into it. Don't get all excited about it. Say, hey, there's something here. Hey, maybe there's causation here. Now just stay calm. Okay, if I could say the one advice for everyone is to remain calm. Okay, don't get agitated. Remain calm. That is really like a cure-all for getting wrapped up into this, into getting off track. Like if I'm listening to a band, it's really great. If I just stay really calm, and don't start singing and dancing and grooving to it. No, stay just real calm, very calm. And you say, okay, yeah, they're really good. But you still feel very calm. Because in that calm, you're able then to turn a voice of clarity very easily. And then just realize, oh, okay, this is belief was trying to distract me and lead me astray. Okay, no reaction. Still stay calm. You're not angry. See, if you're calm, you're not angry. Right? If you're calm, you're not afraid. If you're calm, you're not agitated. If you're calm, you're not getting wrapped up in entertainment, right? No, you're not. Because entertainment is meant to groove you into, get you into a groove of reaction. But if you're really calm, then it's easy to go right into satsang and inquiry, just like that. So you can control your reactions. You can stay calm. You can actually do that. Even if you're not clear about the situation, you can remain calm. You can just breathe calmly. Okay. You cannot sing. You know, you cannot, you can just say, you can keep yourself from singing, right? Anyone could do that. You can keep yourself from singing. And you can even keep yourself from having some song running around in your head, which sometimes is very difficult. That's the problem. I'm listening to this band, the songs got into my head, and it was constantly, like endless loop, just constantly all day running through my head. Oh boy, that's terrible. But you can stop that. Just stay calm. Stay calm. When you hear that, just stay calm. You can keep yourself from dancing. You can do that. You can keep yourself from singing. You can keep yourself from yelling or getting worked up. You can just stay calm. You have control over your breathing, over your motion. You have control over that. You have consciously, you can do that. So start with that. Which I think why in Satsang they say, you know, start with your position, getting in a comfortable position, and then just stay in that position. And then start with your breathing and realize you have control of your breathing. And then calm down so you're in a calm state of mind. And from there, you can start listening to the voice of certitude, the voice of clarity. And you need to keep that calm even while in Satsang, in inquiry. You got to keep that calm. You have to. You don't want to get wrapped up in what's being said either. You don't want to start saying hallelujah and singing songs and jumping up and, you know, getting all excited, emotional and stuff. No. If you see something very clearly, you have a breakthrough, you remain calm. Like you have a wow breakthrough, a wow, say wow. And it's reverberating, you know, this breakthrough, you've had some really wow moment. You keep your breath calm and you keep your motion calm. And you keep your imagination calm. You can do that. Everybody can do that. So, that's the very best advice. From a pragmatic standpoint, that is the very best advice, is to remain calm and patient. Because frustration will eat away at your calm. And one way that I can help you with this is to tell you that belief is a super con artist. Okay, it's super, super con artist. And you're up against a great adversary, okay? A very clever adversary. And so don't get mad at yourself that it's taken you a while. And don't get frustrated that it's taken this long. Because really, this belief is incredibly clever. And it is the adversary. It is really the adversary. And it uses, you know, all of your creativity that you have, that spirit has, to deceive you. So it is not easy to shake off this adversary, to stand up to this bully. It is not easy to do it. And very few people, you know, in the history of this planet have done it. Very few. So, but... you absolutely can do it. And at some point you will do it, because the voice of clarity remains with you always. Even in the afterlife, it remains with you just as much as it remains with you here. It will always be with you. So at some point you will do it. You will stand up to the bully belief, and you will just say, there's room here at this inn for the overlay to arise as an effect. There's room. I've made room. I've kicked, you know, belief out of that room. Belief may still be in one of my rooms, but it's not in this room anymore. And there's no room for belief in this room. So, in spite of being frustrated and saying, wow, this is taking so long, you must remain calm. Must remain calm and patient. That is, you know, it's not easy, but you have power to do that. You have the will to do that. And in doing that, then you're able to make rapid progress. And then you say, okay, I see I'm going to do it. So I'm no reason to get frustrated and lose my cool and just quit and say, I can't do this or whatever. And then you start catching the belief tricking you. You start catching it and say, whoa, wait a minute. Belief's trying to drag me into its lair once again. And you start catching it quicker and quicker and quicker, which means you have more and more time to listen to the voice of clarity, which means you get clearer and clearer and clearer about what the remedy needs to be, which means you get closer and closer and closer to employing this remedy. So it's a very positive thing, but it does hinge upon you remaining calm. Don't lose your calm. And when you lose it, just say, wait a minute. Okay. I never pay attention to my breath. I never did it that way, but you can do it that way. It's probably a great way to do it. What I did was I simply tried to focus on clarity. But you can do it by breath. That's a time-honored technique, is first just calm your breath down. Just calm your breath down. And then you'll find that you're able to look at clarity. I just sort of skipped that, but probably would have been helped to do that. And don't let any of that reaction get going. Stop it in its tracks. And of course there are times where you'll be dragged into the lair of belief as a quote-unquote expert consultant, maybe the top consultant in the world even. You're numero uno. And then you're in the lair of belief, and then the belief will start kicking up some reactions in you, some emotions, all this kind of stuff start going. And you'll want to start like building on that. And you know, you'll even forget there is such a thing. You really will forget there is such a thing. And it may seem boring, like just sitting here, but I can tell you I'm not bored right now at all. Just the opposite. Because I'm feeling how close it is, you know. Success is very close. When I was a kid, we went to a dude ranch and we rode these horses. And we went on this big circle, big loop, you know, of the horses along trails and everything. And I was doing great. I thought I was riding this horse great. And, suddenly my horse started galloping on me. And I said, whoa. You know, I pulled the reins. I said, whoa, whoa. Yelling at us, hey, slow down. And the horse going faster and faster and faster. And I was like, holy cow, this is unbelievable. So I just holding on. And the horse actually was a very clever horse. And there was this, on the trail, there was this pine tree with a branch that went over the trail. And the horse knew that this branch was very low, and that if it went under the branch, it would knock the rider off. So suddenly I saw this branch, and I ducked beneath the horse's head, you know, and it skimmed the top of my head, you know, and I stayed on the horse all the way to the barn, which was quite something. So, but the horse knows when it's getting close to the barn, right? It knows. So it starts galloping. And maybe it tries to knock the rider of belief off or something. I don't know. The analogy is not perfect there. But you might say that belief was trying to knock me off. You know, at the end, the belief tries to knock you astray. You know, and I was able to duck underneath and I stayed on. So like when I know I'm getting close and belief is showing, hey, how about this super band, you know? Can you evaluate this super band for me? Which I've never done, showing me live, you know? I knew they're all about their music. I used to love their music, but never saw them live, and now it's showing me all these videos on YouTube of them live. And I'm seeing them live and I'm saying, holy cow, that might be the best live band I've ever seen. Really, incredibly good live. And then right again, you know, that's that branch across the path that's going to knock me off the horse before I get to the barn. And so I say, I have to back away from that. Like, wow, that's really quite a trick. Because when we were young, I mean, bands were everything, you know. Evaluating bands was everything in my life. That was like, and a lot of people, you know, that was the age of bands, you know. Because before that, bands were different. You'd have acts, you know, you had big bands, but they were tour the country. There were few of those, you know, not many. and they're very well known. There's a couple of big bands, Tommy Dorsey and, you know, whatever. There are a lot of, Artie Shaw. There's a lot of big bands. There are a few big bands, big, well known. But what happened was, with the advent of cheap electronics, electric guitars, electric amplifiers, and drum sets, all this stuff, all these bands, you know, garage bands, started rising everywhere. There were thousands of them, hundreds of thousands all over the world. Just incredible bands like mushrooms. And we were saying, oh my gosh, and look at all this creativity that was coming up. Every band sounded different. Whereas before, the big bands all kind of sound the same, playing the same type of music. Now you had all these bands playing all these different styles. It's incredible. And, you know, some bands started rising to the top, and we were looking like, you know, who are the good bands? I spent all my time listening to bands, you know, whoever put out a record or something, or a tape. There's underground tapes everywhere. You go to a, you know, garage, you go to a practice session and listen to bands. And everybody was like, you know, the talk was, who did you hear, you know? And you ask your friends, who have you seen recently? And they say, well, I saw this one, and this one was good, and they evaluate, and there's this whole network of sharing information on all the bands. So I was trying to cull all this information and find out, you know, where was the best band? Who's the best band? I became fixated on trying to find the best band in the world. And I really, you know, found probably the one that was, you know, live was probably the very best there was, and I tried to tell people then about it, you know, hey, this band was the best. Of course, they broke up very quickly, and they weren't anymore gone. Bands would keep breaking up, and I say, where did the members of the band go, and how do we assemble, you know, a band? And I tried to make my own bands. I tried to assemble. How can you assemble the, you know, like the perfect band? So when I see now like a really great band, I'm like saying, hey, that's pretty interesting. That's the branch across the path that's trying to knock me off the back of the horse. So it's like something got into the horse, you know, belief got into the horse, say, hey, knock this guy off. It was a good horse. The devil got a hold of it, you know, I mean, belief got a hold of it, the horse, and it tried to knock me off its back. But fortunately, it failed, because I could have been really hurt very badly there. Really. I mean, a horse at full gallop with a big, thick branch that has no give to it, smashing me in the head, you know, hey, could have been very, very severe. So, belief got into the horse and told it to go, 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 and then go under that branch, you know. So, just like belief gets into me and says, hey, listen to this band, which could really knock me off track very badly. I'm aware it could really has the potential to knock me off track very badly, and, you know, basically fail, because time is of the essence right now. It really is, because there's this overwhelming movement now on the planet to, you know, assert the will of searching within effects for causation, and to push the envelope severely. And so we got no time to lose right now. That is for sure. And there's a lot of destructivity coming, as those back east know firsthand now. I mean, I've been saying this for my whole life, and beating this drum recently very strongly, like, hey, folks, you know, dance of destructivity is coming. Big time. And those back east now know that this is not a joke. It wasn't just Whistling Dixie, you know. I mean, this is... You know, they're feeling it, and they realize the domino effect of how it works. First, you say, it's just a storm. We got some flooding. You know, we got the powers out. We got no gas. We can't run the generators for the pumps. We can't get supplies in because trucks don't have the gas. We can't get rid of all this debris because don't have the gas. You know, here comes another storm. It's freezing. We don't have heat. On and on and on and on and on. You know, it's a domino effect. What I'm saying in the world is a domino effect. It's not isolated. Once the dominoes start falling, you're up a creek without a paddle. So it's not... time is of the essence, which I've been pushing. Very pushy. Put a lot of pressure on. Because it has to. We have to put pressure on right now. So I'm putting pressure on myself intensely. Have been. intensely. See? There's the emergency. It's an emergency. We are in an emergency. I've been in full emergency mode for 15 years. Because I was shown what's going to happen to this world 15 years ago, October, the end of October, beginning of November in 1997. I was shown, and also January 1st in 1998. January 1st, 1998, also I was shown crystal clear the entirety of the future of this cycle, what is going to happen, how it ends, everything. And so far, everything is right on track, exactly as I was shown. So at that point, I shifted into complete emergency mode. Every single day, I treated like a full-on emergency, which has been very tough. Didn't let myself relax at all. I get up every day and say, this is a total emergency. We are in a world crisis right now. World crisis right now. There's an avalanche coming that's going to take 15 years to reach us, so to speak. But it will reach us. And I was told, 15 years is when it's going to reach us. So basically, for me, I'm saying, by the time of January 1st, 2013, which would be 15 years, all hell's going to break loose. It's really problems. The dominoes will really start falling. So, we have how many days, till that time? I think, was it 52 days? I can dial that up for you. 51 days. We have 51 days to go. So it's full on emergency, and I'm pushing things for you, pushing things for me, pushing things for you. And the good news is we're gonna make it. That's the good news, because in that vision that I was shown, for sure I make it, for sure. Tremendous boost. I completely reversed directions, totally, and belief was totally upset with me, totally upset with me. I mean, to the point of pulling its hair out, that's how mad it was, because I escaped belief. I went in the right direction, complete opposite direction of belief, and so I know that will happen, and I was able to stand up to belief. It wasn't easy. Belief was screaming curses at me, absolutely screaming curses at me. Forever, you're damned forever. You're the worst, blah, blah. Just the vilest curses imaginable. And I just, see ya. Just went in the right direction. So, I have very great confidence that a big boost will come. And that we can stand up to that bully of belief. And we can go in the right direction, which is standing up to it. Going in the right direction is the way you have to stand up to the bully belief. You can't go in the direction of belief and just argue with it, trying to convince it. Because again, you can't argue with insanity. There's nothing there to convince. It can't say, okay, I see the clarity of what you're saying. Insanity cannot do that. And belief is insanity. It is the child of insanity. So, there you go. How are we doing here? Very great. We're doing great. So I know I'm going to make it. And I know that is a boost for everyone. Anyone that's able to stand up to boy belief and go in the right direction is a great, great asset. Great help. And, 51 days, treat it like an emergency that it is. It is an emergency. It's an absolute emergency. And those of you back east, you are at ground zero again. Back east, it seems like New Yorkers and back east, that area, they're at ground zero. I mean, they were at ground zero of 9/11, which really kicked things off. I mean, that should have been an eye-opener for everyone, because that began the entire corruption of the legal system of America, of freedom, all the stuff. I mean, it started imposing a draconian system, which trying to force everyone to search for causation within belief, within effects, instead of accepting the overlay. It's trying to force that issue. So, back east, 9/11, and the Pentagon and all that happened on everything that happened on 9/11, was was back there. And, you know, and from that, you know, things have changed irrevocably. You know, it's just like night and day, the differences. So again, Sandy comes in. Again, you're ground zero, okay? For even more draconian changes. I mean, I think they're rationing gasoline now. But it's good for you that there's some place, some people, some which was, are not getting, you know, hit real hard, because they still have this, you know, confidence and certainty and reassurance that can reach you. And you can say, okay, so belief is hammering us right now, but we can escape belief. Yes, we can. But certainly those who are on the leading edge of the storm, you know, hey, it's a wake-up call. So out here on the left coast, as they call it, in this beautiful Bay Area, in the beautiful place I'm at, that I'm not forgetful of the fact that it is an emergency, it is a world crisis. The crisis really is the last 15 years have been an absolute world crisis. And then really getting a big push in 9/11 in 2001 was like, you know, kaboom, hey, it should wake up call for the whole world, you know. But the wake up call really arrived earlier for me. 51 days, so let's push it. Let's stay with it. Stay with the truth. The truth will stay with you. And the big boost is coming. You will find out that the bully of belief can be stood up to. And in seeing that, you will say, aha, I have it within me too. When you do, you have it within you. I am 100% certain of that. Okay, stay with the truth and the truth will stay with you. And let's end this video on that note. Very great.